Hello and very warm welcome in this edition of Insight. The historic decision of demonetization of a huge chunk of the currency is now showing some of the move where a common man will have a sigh of relief in one of the steepest cuts in borrowing rates in recent time. Leading banks lowered their lending rates on Sunday by up to 19 basis points a day after PM Modi suggested that the deshould focus on the poor, lower middle class and middle class. The country's largest bank, SBI, reduced the overnight marginal cost of funds-based lending rate, that's MCLR, to 7.75% from 8.6%. MCLR is the benchmark lending rates at which a bank prices all its loans. The new loan rates will be effective from January 1st. SBI had cut home loans rates to 9.1%, the lowest in 6 years. Punjab National Bank cut the overnight lending rates by 17 basis points to 8.20%, while Union Bank of India slashed the rates by 65 to 19 BPS for different tenures. PM's speech to the nation on 31st December gave some indications to relief to some of the people. He announced some soaps to common man in shape of rate cuts on interest rate. The most important takeaway from budget-like speech by the Prime Minister was his proposed changes in the realty sector in a bid to woo the middle class and the lower income class Indian the most. Modi announced interest rate rebates of 4% and 3% of the housing loans up to 9 lakhs and rupees 12 lakhs respectively under the PM Awas Yojana. He made vital announcement for the agriculture sector, for pregnant women as well as senior citizens. But few of the skeptics are also asking, where are the facts and tangible data about the demonetization's initial success? How much black money has returned to the government since November 9? How much cash out of the 15.44 lakh crore is back in the banks? Will the government make some direct transfer to Jan Dhan accounts? What is behind his cautious take on the political funding? So we would be discussing this all with the panel of guests in this edition of Insight. Mr. Ashutosh is with me, business journalist. Welcome in the show, Ashutosh. Mr. Akash Jindal is with us. He is a global economist.
Akash Jindal,
bahut bahut swagat. Or Mr. P.K. Chaubey, economic analyst. Mr. P.K. Chaubey, welcome. First question to Ashutosh. How do you see this cutting down the interest rate and the any positive impact on the mood, especially the mood, the sentiments of the nation?
You know, I'll start with, it's great news for consumers, great news for the economy, because it does need a kickstart. That is very important. You need to neutralize, you know, some of the squeeze that was felt by the economy after the announcement on 8th of November. So it is great news, it's welcome news. And if you see, particularly focusing on the housing sector, if that takes off, it, you know, typically they say in the housing sector, you have, it has connections with nearly 250 different sectors in the economy. So if you buy a new house, you need to buy, you know, employ people to do the furniture, to do buy some consumer goods, probably buy a few other things, get some more. So all that economic activity fuels something across the economy. So it is great news, but it's very important to make sure that this momentum doesn't lose pace over the next few weeks and months, I would think. That is critical, because this, the government needs to make sure that this advantage that you have given by trying to push this demand artificially, I would say, because this really was not needed if demonetization had not happened. So this should be taken, this should be, you know, you need to take a step or two further to make sure that it picks up momentum.
Mr. Jindal, how do you see the declining interest rate will boost the or reinvigorate the, especially the realty sector? Do you see any hope in this sector?
I see a lot hope. I think for me, it's a great news, because one, housing is a priority. I mean, government has been saying 2022, by 2022, they want to give houses to everybody.
Everyone.
Roti, kapda aur makan, that has been the three priority sectors. And I think as a nation, it's our duty to give houses to everybody. Now, firstly, this would give a big boost to housing. Because typically, my organization, akashindal.in, has been serving in India. All of us Indians like to own our own homes. I mean, people in US may think differently. They may stay in a rented accommodation for their entire life or generation, but we want to own a home. Firstly, it would be a great booster for housing sector. Secondly, it would be a major booster for the economy. Because what does housing sector mean? Housing sector means steel. Housing sector means cement. Housing sector means woodwork. Housing sector means lot of people to do furnishing, sanitary ware, paints. So many industries are connected with it.
Especially the unorganized sector coming back to the system.
Unorganized sector, and particularly, you are very right. I've been doing stories and stories on people, the most important person, the 400 rupees laborer who has been rendered jobless. Now, housing sector is the most powerful, I would say, intensive employment sector. It provides employment from our friend who earns 400 rupees daily, the construction worker, to our friend who is earning 40,000 rupees daily as a super specialist architect, masons, carpenters, painters, I mean, so many people, truckers, security guards, so many people you need.
Right.
So I think I have done a calculation. According to my calculation, the calculation of my organization, Akash Dal.in, 0.6% incremental impact it can have on GDP. So I think, plus when you talk about housing sector, see, the developers have not been doing well. So they also needed some help, some support. With more and more people going in and buying in houses, it would be a support for them. Because what had happened is, typically, since I deal with that sector, I'm a real estate expert also. Now, somebody who had come out with 200 flats, he had sold 150 flats. Now, he needed to sell another 30 or 40 flats out of those 50 flats to complete the construction in order to give houses to all those 150 people who had booked in. So this would be a great support to them. Now, bankers, we all know, are not keen to lend to developers. But for somebody who is working in a good job, they'll lend the money to him. Ultimately, the money is going to go to developer. So I think it's a big boost. And this is what I said in November also, when people were talking about negatives of demonetization. See, with all this 15 lakh crores, now what do banks do? The money has come in savings account, where banks have to pay 4% to 7% interest. Some money in December has been shifted to fixed deposits, where banks have to pay 7 to 8%.
This is also debatable that whatever the money has come back to the bank, that eventually will not stay in the banks. It will go into the system, and the whatever the cash inflow can benefit. But entire money cannot remain in the bank.
See, firstly, it's a very, very interesting question, I would say. It's a very nice question. I think perhaps a major component is going to stay. Because what has happened is, typically the money which was lying in almirahs, lockers, cushions, rajais, that money has come in, and that money is perhaps going to stay. Now, bankers, typically what they do is, they have to deploy the money. Because otherwise, you have to pay interest on that, and you are not earning, you'll get into losses. So what do you do? Either you buy government bonds, or you do some lending here. So I think, and we have seen, withdrawals have not been there. In fact, that has been the question, that people have been not taking away that money.
Right.
I think bankers getting flushed with funds. What do bankers do? They have to lend that money somewhere. I think it's a big boost. And if implemented well, this could be a game changer. Demonetization, till now people were saying GDP has lessened, money is not coming, international money is not coming. This could kickstart the entire economy, because I've been saying it earlier, you start the housing sector, you give a kickstart to the housing sector, you can have a cascading impact on the entire economy. So this is what it is. I mean, if you ask me, I'll keep on naming, go up to advertising industry, go up to newspapers, TV channels who are getting a lot of advertisements from realtors. So entire economy would almost be covered, because realtors these days, I mean, real estate developers, they have been giving you finished houses, they have been buying TV sets, air conditioners to be fitted in
the
houses.
Much of the soap, Simon, to woo the customer.
So
the
entire,
the entire economy would be impacted positively.
Okay, do you also believe this can be the game changer, Mr. Chaubey? And otherwise, the government had to do it to soothe the feelings of the nation, because they were very hazzled.
The first thing that they had to soothe the feeling. That is very, very important. But the second part, as other friends have suggested, once, I mean, this cash, part of it was active, part of it was stashed. But nevertheless, when cash reaches the bank, then deposits increase. And deposits have multiplier impact. Cash doesn't have multiplier impact. It gets landed. And that is why money multiplier, something we talk in economics. Isn't it? So that way, but whether that is taking place. Now, if it is not active, so the banks had to lend, and perhaps they were, because so far they were not busy with other things. So they, it was not getting easy for them to process what you call applications for so on. And the second, I mean, on the demand side we have discussed, but the supply side, because they have suggested for MSME, isn't it? Some soft for MSME. So that is the supply side. Of course, I mean, they are interconnected. As you say, linkages are there, and housing sector does have, I mean, multiple linkages, and perhaps strongest linkages. But important part is, it is not the general housing. It is a particular segment, and therefore feeling part is very, very important. The 12 lakh and 9 lakh, kind of house, and you understand, I mean, suppose in Delhi, a middle class person buy, a house for 50 lakh. Not 9 lakh and 12 lakh. Okay. So that segment part is important, and the soothing part therefore is important. So I think psychology plays a great role.
Okay.
I mean, if you psychologically feel depressed, isn't it? You stop doing many of the activities which you would have been otherwise doing. So this vibrancy has to come through that kind of feeling. It may not be very big quantum, but the message value, it has got a great message value. And once that message value is, I mean, what do you call, encashed, so to say.
Do you also believe that this is only the cosmetic gesture, especially to soothe the feeling of the nation, otherwise, and before, just 1 month prior to the budget, it was not very necessary?
I'll give you an example of the stock markets. In the stock markets, there are three things which are critical to, you know, the stock markets functioning properly. First is the sentiment. Sentiment can change any minute, every second as well. So this is what is a sentiment changer. Given what has been happening in the last 6 to 7 weeks or 8 weeks. So this changes sentiment from the extreme negative sentiment. This changes sentiment. Then comes the capital. Now suddenly banks are flush with funds. They can lend at a cheaper rate. Maybe. So you are trying to put money into the hands, cheaper money in the hands of the masses, because the, you know, professor mentioned about the classes which we are addressing.
Right.
So those are the 9 lakh and 12 lakh kind of caps that you're putting on the loans. So those are typically non-urban or semi-urban kind of housing. So again, that changes the, that adds capital to it. And hopefully, the third step of that is the fundamentals. Hopefully, you'd hope that it can change the fundamentals for the economy, because we are moving towards a consumption-driven economy. We are not the saving-driven economy of the yesteryears.
And Mr. Jindal, I mean, there was a general perception when the demonetization drive was going on, the government was advertising benefits, I mean, telling that the normal 20 to 30% of the rates, of the, especially the realty sector's rate, housing rates will come down. Do you see that any possibility of happening? Especially, let's say, any flat rates of 1 crore will come down to 70 lakhs or to 75 lakhs. Do you see any possibility of this? Otherwise, only the interest rate will come down and you have a lesser EMI to pay to the banks.
I think what has happened is, since 2013, since I deal with the real estate industry, I am my hands dipped in that water. So prices have been coming down on a regular basis. And you
since
are very right.
2013?
Since 2013.
Okay.
I am typically talking about concentrating basically on NCR. But this is this holds good for Punjab also, Mumbai area, MMR area also, except for some exceptions like Bengaluru. Otherwise, they have been coming down in the past 4 years. So already prices have dropped by a considerable level. I'll give you a value. I'll give you an example of Noida Extension, which is basically Greater Noida West. Now, today the flats are available at a rate. There are two components to a flat. One is the cost of land at which the authority is giving land to the developers. Secondly, the construction cost. Now, if you just see the cost of land at which the authority today is allotting land, and a construction cost of around 1400 rupees per square feet.
Okay.
That rate, at that landed cost, flats are already available. So in certain areas, prices have already come to that level, which is the actual cost to the developer.
Okay.
So there is not much scope of prices going down. There was not much scope in prices going down.
Okay.
Yes, if the developer is not performing well, or if he has to compulsorily sell 30, 40 flats in order to complete his building, maybe he may sell 5%, 7% more. That would be out of the cost. So I don't see much of cost reductions. But yes, sales have been down in the month of November and December. So further also, I don't see much price correction. But now I think there would be some demand. On the same hand, I don't expect price escalation. What I expect is that certain constructions which had stopped midway, which were not doing well because the developer wasn't getting money, now those constructions would restart, plus the benefit would be for those 150 people also who had already paid in the money, their flats were also get constructed. So what I mean to say is the housing industry needed a boost badly, and this is one boost. Rather than, I mean, I never endorsed that feeling which came from the ruling party that prices should drop further, because there is not much scope for prices to come down further.
Okay.
So rather this is a better and a positive angle to this thing. This would rather impact the economy very well, and globally also, since China is doing too badly right now.
Right.
Otherwise also US also, yes, there are indication they may do well. Europe is not doing good. So we have a chance to steer ahead of other nations. So that's why I am quite bullish and happy. And yes, we are talking about budget homes, but the reduction in rates have been for homes which are higher priced also. So I think overall it would have a lot positive impact in case it's implemented well.
Okay. So one more question to you, Ashutosh. I mean, with the lending rates coming down, do you expect especially the bankers can expect credit offtake, especially to the corporates to pick up?
I don't see that happening directly. I mean, given the state of the economy, you have to keep in mind what are the kind of jobs that we are creating in the market.
Okay.
That market particularly is slow. So if the consuming class is not getting ready, I see lesser incentive for companies. So you have to look at very closely at the core sector data, which is about 38% of our economy. So you have to look at that. If that starts to do well, because that will have typically input on what the rest of the economy looks like, then you are sure that it will take off. But till the time the core sector does well, which is steel, cement, electricity, power, and all those sectors, petroleum, till the time there is better numbers coming out of the core sector, I don't see that great offtake really happening.
How do you see, Mr. Chaubey, do you see any sort of picking up the credit offtake, especially to the corporate sector? Can bank expect credit offtake picking up, especially to the corporate sector?
I think, because that part, you see, that cash part is very small part of the total money, isn't it? It's not that high. But the psychology and the people who deal with that cash part, isn't it? That is very, very important. So for me, I think corporate sector is wherever it was, isn't it? It was having current account, it was changing, isn't it? It was disbursing and taking whatever. That activity was not slackened. The activity that slackened was the people who were dealing or who were using, cash, isn't it? So now that part is important, and that segment has to be what you call psychologically dealt with, and these softs are for them. The other part, reality sector, I am not that sanguine. Because reality sector, in fact, even if the credit is available, the house is not getting constructed, I am not borrowing, isn't it? Actually, most of us have been borrowing. And these are the things on ground. The bank doesn't, lend to the developers, isn't it? That is what I'm saying.
I would like to say something after this.
Okay.
This is very interesting.
This is very interesting because they ask the developer to have the customer, and they will pay to the customer. That is how they are asking the developer. So developer says that loan is available, and they are coming in between, but they are not borrowing because the bank is not willing to
give it to the developers.
And the risk is very high.
Wow.
So they want to retail, isn't it? Rather than paying to, say, OMEX, isn't it? They will pay to PK Chaubey, isn't it? And OMEX will say that such and such bank is willing to give on this project. Now, the project is not coming, so I am not willing, and the bank is also not willing. Because most of the projects are before this demonetization. Demonetization has nothing to do with much of the reality sector having come down, isn't it?
Okay.
And many of them perhaps made miscalculation that the prices will keep on escalating, so they didn't sell 20%, 30%, 40% houses, isn't it? When the prices will escalate, something will they get. So they have gotten now liquidity crisis, And that liquidity crisis has nothing to do with the demonetization.
Okay.
They have got assets, but those assets are also illiquid. So most of the things are not happening. I don't know even which way they will seek the, what you call, there's something political, and the government is trying to do, I mean, again, through the customers, not even helping the developers.
The developers in the world. You wanted to say something? Yeah.
What my friend Professor said is very interesting. With due regards to what he has said, since I deal with the real estate sector, now what has happened, how it's actually going to help. Now, yes, they are going to give the money to the developer through a customer, because if the money is given to a customer, ultimately that money is going to help the construction process. Now, if you do a survey, which I keep on doing in Gurgaon, Noida Extension, or other areas of NCR, now what has happened is buildings you'll see. Now, building the superstructure is ready, but what happens is the woodwork has to be done, sanitary fittings have to be done, electrical work has to be done. So what it means is typically 20 to 25% more things have to be done, or 20 to 25% talking straight, money has to be invested.
Okay.
Now, who is going to invest that money? If you get in, like I gave you an example, 200 flats are being built, 150 you have already sold in. Their people, after seeing the superstructure, they have given the entire money. Now, who will give the money for the rest of the 20%? Those 50 people who will buy the flats, they'll give you money which you can finish it. And the 150 people who had already bought the flat, they'll also stand to gain. So that's how I am saying, by getting in 50 more people, you can give houses to 150 earlier people who were stuck in, because the developer was not in a position to complete that. It was not that the developer didn't want to complete. He wants to complete. That's his, in his selfish interest, because in case he completes a particular project, then of course he can go on launching another project number 2, 3 and 4. So this is, I think, going to help there, because the last mile thing which he wanted.
But what makes any difference? Eventually the money is going to the developer. And
the money is waste. That's what I wanted to say. The money is going to the developer. Okay. And in fact, on lending also, the question you asked my friends, what has been very interesting is, January to March of 2015, I still remember, I've been doing back-to-back shows, including the one with you on NPS. So what happened is, January to March, it was NPS, NPS, NPS. So after that, bankers, what they have been doing is, they have been typically lending to 200 or 250 top corporates. They have not been lending to the corporates, which were mid-sized corporate or lower-level corporates. The money has been concentrated in the hands of few people, because the banker was suspicious. The banker never wanted to lend money and get into an NPA. There were accusations also on bankers. This has been done, this has been done. So ultimately, the money was not going in for the growth of the economy. I mean, the money was not being scattered or dispersed. I mean, the what you call inclusive growth, that was not happening. This is something which can lead to inclusive growth. So I think this can have a lot of impact on the real estate sector, particularly the buildings who are on the verge of completion.
But what is the what is the surety of giving the any house on time? The time bound delivery was the major setback, especially since last couple of years. So what was the surety on that front?
I think it's a very important question, that it has been delayed. One, I would say this doesn't guarantee any surety, but what guarantees the surety is RERA coming in. Now, with RERA coming in and all the norms being coming in, now developers know it for sure that either you give deliveries properly, or
you have
you
to face the
or you have to face the music, or you won't be there as developers for long. So RERA is already impacting, as we are talking about psychological impact. RERA is already as a psychological impact on all the
before
developers.
Before going to the break, Ashutosh wanted to say something.
Yeah, I was talking about, you know, very important point that he raised about RERA. So you have to register a project with RERA, and you know, each state has its own regulatory body. So there is some teeth, hopefully, and it will work. I wanted to make the point also about, you know, the sweet spot for lending for real estate is about 8%. Anything lower, it gets even better. So if you look at the boom around 2004, 5, 6, almost up to 7, I would think, about 10 years ago, that is. So we hit a low of 7.25%, if I remember it correctly. The moment, so we are still 8 plus today. So the moment we start getting closer to 8 and below, really it becomes, borrowing for a housing loan becomes very exciting for a buyer. So you'll have, again, you'll probably get to the other side where it starts heating up. But the closer you get to 8%, the better it is for lenders, because then it's really cheap for lending, and of course.
But what will happen to the fixed deposit? It will come down because lending rates are coming down. Yes, it will be negative. We will discuss after the short break, because the banks are flush with their funds, and what is the what will the ensuing benefit in terms of the other sectors? We will be discussing after this short break. Welcome back. With the PM's budget-like speech on 31st night has given some hope to the common person, and the reduction in the MCLR is expected to positively impact in loan growth both in the retail consumer segment and in corporate sector lending. But before going to the break, Ashutosh, I was asking you, with the lending rates cutting down, it gives some hope, but it will not be a good sign for the, especially the senior citizens who are investing money in fixed deposits. How do you see it?
Well, it's true. I mean, you cannot have your cake and eat it too, as they say it. So, well, when you're getting your home loans and other loans cheaper, and you're getting other SOPs, so for example, the senior citizen SOPs, for a particular section of the society, you're giving home loans which are way cheaper than what the market rate is, then you're going to be, you have to cut some corners. Effectively, that means that we're moving, and it's written pretty large, I would say, on the wall. The writing is very clear on the wall that we're moving to an economy which is lower cost economy, where the savings rate will not be the, you know, the bank saving rate will not be what it was. So what you see today, for example, I mean, you see various banks which advertise 6% and 7%. So we had about 3 years ago when the savings rate was freed from the control. So some banks today, so a Yes Bank, I believe, still does give 7% or something like that. Kotak still gives you 6%. Some other banks give you 4%. I'm pretty sure that we are headed to a time where it'll be pushed down further.
Okay.
And it'll happen sooner than what we imagine.
Mr. Jindal, how do you see that? Why cutting the corners for this elderly people, I mean, who are at the fag end of their life? With this news, they will not be very happy. So can government do some sort of a relief to them, or it had to happen eventually to them?
I think yes, we are in for a lesser rate of interest regime, that's for sure. Because our rates of interest have been quite high in comparison. I mean, with what we have seen in US, Europe, in Japan, rather, there have been negative rates of interest. You have bonds which get you negative rate of interest. You have to pay from your pocket. In case I want you to keep my money, I have to pay you for keeping my money. So we are definitely in for a lesser interest rate regime, but I totally endorse what you somebody who has called it a day, he wants to live off that money. So basically we should get him a regular interest. I think this scheme which they have now announced, that 8% interest would be there, but that scheme would be coming in with a 10-year perhaps lock-in. It's the words have been used, it's a 10-year scheme. So I expect that it could be perhaps a lock-in, or it could have a premature withdrawal penalty. So I think perhaps some senior citizens could go into that, but otherwise there's another answer. I'll tell you. Real estate also, we are planning schemes, REITs, Real Estate Investment Trust. What we do abroad is, now what happens is, with real estate going up, money could go into REITs. The government has already allowed that. Now in a REITs, what would happen is a developer would construct a particular building. That building would be rented out, and from the rentals, they'll be paying dividends, they'll be paying money to the investors. So I think what can happen is, why do we only think that our elderly people should invest only in fixed deposits? We should give them other options also. One already is mutual funds. Mutual funds have good schemes. I mean, equity schemes, debt schemes. And REITs could be the answer, wherein a particular building could be built up. It could be let out to people, and out of the rentals, you could pay the dividend. And of course, at the end of 7 year or 10 year period, it's India here, capital appreciation for real estate, except for the 4 years, is quite fast, because ultimately what is happening is population is increasing, land is not increasing, because real estate, let me tell you, it's the best investment also. Now typically, let me inform the viewers what happens.
Yes, it
is the best. I'll tell you why so. Now, even if you buy a flat, if you are paying 100 rupees for buying a flat, 75 typically goes for the land value. 25 is for the construction and furnishing. Now, land is something which can't be increased.
Right,
okay,
that's right.
People keep on increasing. Mm. We keep on producing babies. Mm. So supply is limited. Mm. We can't construct more land.
Mm.
Okay, we did try it. Mm. I mean, reclamation and all that.
Mm.
What the nature does is it comes with one tsunami or one Rita Katrina. Right. Whatever we have tried to reclaim, it ultimately squares it off. So the message from nature is very clear.
Mm.
I mean, don't try to take pangas with me. So don't try to, you can't have more land, but we keep on having more and more babies. So ultimately what happens is supply is limited.
And the demand will be
Demand will keep on growing, particularly with the nuclear family. If you talk about, I mean, entire India, the Bahu, when it comes into a family, 1 year, 2 years down, I can already see the smile on your face. She wants a separate two bedroom home for herself.
Right.
So what it means that this is something where the demand is not going to, demand is going to increase and supply is going to ultimately dry up to a certain extent. So it's a good investment.
Okay.
Just one small point to the point that you mentioned about the REITs for real estate. So these REITs could be educational REITs as well. So schools which own land, that could be leased to somebody and that company can pay rental. And similarly, depending upon what the regulation is, some investor could be earning money out of that. Now, whether we choose to make it a retail investor, whether we choose to make it an institutional investor, is something that policymakers have to decide.
One more thing. Banks have retained their base rates. So, will the existing borrowers will be benefited, or this new lending rates cutting down will have only the positive effect to the people who will buy or will apply for the loan?
I'll typically, actually, MCLR, how it functions is basically it's a base rate or a benchmark rate for which, on the basis of which you set rates for 1 year.
Okay.
So particularly, typically those people who could have borrowed in the month of August or September, they may not stand to gain because what you have fixed the rates for 1 year.
Okay.
So they may not gain, but typically those people who want to buy, that could be a very big booster for those people. And I think,
for example, let's say I've been paying whatever the interest since last 6 years or 7 years. Will I be benefited with this?
That's what I was trying to come to. Okay. Let me say a bit naughty thing now. We want new people to come in. The people who have already bought in the month of August or September, they are already committed, no?
Okay. So
we want new people to come in.
Uh-huh.
So that's why. So this would benefit the new people. Plus the banks, they could do something to have in the existing borrowers also. There would be certain schemes and adjustments which would fit in the existing borrowers also, because earlier also we have seen whenever there have been interest rate reductions, I mean, already floating rate of interest concept is already there in loans. People are already aware of that. So typically the existing borrowers also would have relief, particularly somebody who has bought in and taken a loan in August or September. Overall, the economy is going to increase. Overall, all the borrowers are going to gain from that. And ultimately, it would have a quite substantial positive effect on the economy.
You have you seen any sort of a positive impact to the people who have already borrowed the loans?
Real sector. In fact, what I understand is that there is always a ratchet effect. It's not every day you are, queuing up the bank and swapping, this bank is giving 0.25% lower, immediately go to the bank and, I don't do. Normally people don't do. Maybe 5%, 10% people can do it. That possibility does exist. The second, if there is force majeure, if your rate, suppose 3% up or 3% down, then your rate is changed by the bank. Otherwise, the rate stays on. So it's easy to say that everything equilibrium, everybody is, whenever there is an opportunity, I will rush. But that doesn't happen, and that can't happen because there are other things. I have to come to Lok Sabha TV. So there are reasons. I postpone the things for a day, isn't it? I had to give some check, okay? So, if you are occupied, but unfortunately, is there really so much of demand? These softs will improve the demand a little bit here and there. And moreover, as my friend said about sentiments in the stock market. A stock market is of course a short-term phenomenon, but it changes only, it shifts money from my pocket to your pocket. It doesn't produce anything. It only gives some idea, if investment can take place in the corporate or in some other sector, isn't it? So some investment in the reality, the physical investment, only that will boost any economy. So when Suppose as an there are two things. Economy investment is in real terms, and person invest in normally in finance terms these days. Earlier, we used to invest directly, making our own house.
Okay.
So now, when we talk of in financial terms, it depends. If I am not going to invest in a stock market, whether I should go for deposit, or whether I should go for gold, or I should go for real estate.
Depositing the fixed deposit.
Bank.
Is not the good idea at the point of time now?
No, it's still a good idea for people who are, not every day. Suppose this, how many of us do see the stock market going
down and up?
Down or up. And if that were there, then the Chidambaram was not trying, isn't it, to push the market, isn't it, by not taxing, long-term capital gains and so on. I might have done.
I want to say something on this demand thing.
Okay.
So I think if you ask me, demand is there. There's lot of demand, too much of demand. Why so? Now, when you are comparing real estate with other investment avenues, now what happens, the difference between other investment avenues and real estate is for somebody, like somebody who has migrated from UP, Bihar to Delhi. Typically, we'll see so many of friends doing it. Now, if they buy gold, if they buy a bank FD, they can't stay in that. So the real estate, typically what it gives you is, it gives you a place to stay in. Plus, it's a very good investment also.
Right.
And as I said in the beginning, we Indians love to own our homes. Typically we don't have that mentality which is in US. US, you'll find people who don't want to own a home. Here, if I have migrated from Punjab to Delhi, after 2 years, I'll make an excited phone call to my mother.
That I have
a
home.
So this is something which gives us a lot of satisfaction, a high, and perhaps since childhood we have been taught this thing. He has now made, this is one of the barometers of success.
Right.
Since I have migrated from a small town of Punjab and I am staying in Delhi, so I'll tell you, this is something which I am giving you a true life example. This is what happens. So demand is very much there, and the nuclear family concept, it keeps on pushing for the demand. Now, in case of budget homes, what is going to happen is, in some cases, EMI is going to be lesser than that of rent.
Okay.
So if you are paying rent 7,000 and the EMI is going to be 6,000, so what happens is, and typically developers have certain schemes wherein you could shift into a house, then you keep on paying EMI. So things like that is going to work wonders. So demand is there. Some of the demand is latent. That is not apparent, because when you don't have money, you can't, but you want to.
What else do you expect in the union budget? Because since only the 1 month away, do you expect any soaps in terms of other lowering interest rate or something else? How do you see that?
See, in a typical classic economic situation where you have the economy which is slightly not quite the robust economy that we talk in the context of India, you'd want to put more money in the hands of people. So typically that means you'd want to cut down or either your tax rates or give some kind of SOPs so that consumption increases. That's what will boost the demand. So across sectors, so when people buy finance more products or services, that's what will increase. So you can expect that to happen. But I'm pretty surprised given the way, and if that is an indicator, I don't think it's a great thing. We had petroleum price increase even yesterday. Now, given the markets that they are, given the petroleum scenario, the global petroleum prices, crude oil prices, it gives me the impression that oil companies are at the moment making up for some of the losses that they had in the past.
Okay.
Which may not, because ultimately the impact that higher petroleum prices and diesel prices have on the economy is something that will not help you become a well-lubricated, you know, cost-efficient economy. That, and ultimately it eats into the savings of every individual. So look at the kind of money that state governments and central government is making out of taxing petrol products.
And what do you have to say about the few of the skeptics of this move of demonetization, that the entire money, the entire black money has not come into the, because government has not come up with the data
that how much black money was there. The entire discourse of black money has now shifted to the digital payments. Do you see that this will have any sort of an impact, a positive or negative, on the Indian economy?
I don't know about the number. I mean, it's
not out there.
Yeah, so probably some people in the government know about the number. Mm. But what I'm very sure is not all money into the system is black money. That I'm very sure. Mm. I myself deposited about 60,000 rupees. I mean, there's no harm mentioning it. Mm. Because that was the kind of money that is lying in the house. I have an elderly mother who stays with me, and I need to keep some money in the house. So I'm sure there are many people who've deposited that kind of money, and it is entirely accounted for. Yes, there is some large chunks. And typically, if you can attack that large chunk of money, the big evaders, that is where, you know, the fear will be there in the people who are engaged in such practices. So I think that will itself be positive. And of course, the good part is that if they own up, then they pay up that 50-odd% of tax, plus lock their money for 3 or 4 years into the government scheme. Mm. So that is good for the economy. Again, that is a push that you're giving to the economy, which we are still not accounting for. So that push, and if it's done the right way, I think it's great positive for the economy.
How do you see it?
Now, what happens is, I think what my dear friend has said is very right. Many of the people who had white money, like he gave an example that he deposited 60,000 rupees. Now, what I want to say, my point here is, lots and lots of black money perhaps has been deposited in banks because people had fear factor on their heads.
Okay.
If I don't go and deposit that money, that money would become worthless after 30th of December. Now, how do we explain the lots of crores which have been deposited into Jan Dhan accounts?
Okay.
Now, here also, if we have deposited 15 lakh crores, now deposit into a bank doesn't mean that it's a white money.
Are you trying to say that the government is not been able to understand that where the black money has been or been deposited or what?
What I want to say is now the government is in a much, much better position to identify what is black money, because earlier that 15 lakh crores, some of the amount may be in pillows, some amount maybe in quilts, some amount maybe in lockers, in water tanks. Now that money is reported.
Okay.
That money is recorded.
Okay.
If I have gone ahead and deposited 8 lakh rupees, I am owning up to this much money I am having. Now the government has the power. The income tax department can jolly well see how much is the cash in hand, which is called typically baki in local language, and how much as I have deposited, and I have they have evidence for that. I have signed the pain slip and deposited money into my account. Till the money was in my quilt, till the money was in my, you can say, water storage or a water tanky, nobody knew about it. So now, if we properly investigate it, lot of black money can be taken out of it.
Okay.
And again, we have heard stories where people were offering 20%. In order to have rokad baki, I mean, if people can understand rokad baki, this is a typical illegal concept wherein you pay somebody black money, you get white money entry, so that you show that this is white money. So all those people who were into this business, I mean, in the November, they had, I would say, heyday, because people were rushing to them. So black money is there in the system, and now it's for the government and the investigating agencies, particularly income tax. They can very well find out and identify the black money holders, and they can take action, which they should. And that is something which is going to press people, because people in India can't be, I think, motivated for Garib Kalyan Yojana, that 50 and 25%. But if there is fear that, yes, you'll be caught, then people would go and deposit money in that 50% plus 25% scheme, which is again going to be used for the betterment of poor.
Do you also see that it would be difficult, the post-demonetization effect, I mean, ensuing effect of this move, What will be the benefits?
I mean, as they say, that 85% of the cash was in 500 rupees note and 1,000 rupees note. Some of this just were lying inactive, isn't it? Whether white or black, it has become active. So this is very important part. The second, that there is a fear. I mean, as I agree, I have quite a bit of it. But as all cash was not black. The all black money is not in cash,
but
there is a lot of black money which is not part of the cash. So cash part we have been able to somewhat, I mean, have access to find out what part is black. I mean, we do not still know how much is black. But definitely, I mean, those who were earning in substantial amount in cash or putting in cash, I mean, they may get some, what you call, paying 45% or something, they can even walk out and make it white. But I again insist that many of the business transactions, they may be of any kind, they are not always in cash and they are still black. So that part we still do not know where it is. All that, I mean, if suppose ISI estimates say 400 crore rupees. The second part, it may be a small, cash part may be very small, but where it is? Now for a terrorist organization, it is huge.
Okay.
So that, I mean, where it is? I mean, if it is one rupee everywhere, it doesn't matter much. But if it is, I mean, 1,000 crore with you, then it matters.
Okay, so one final comment from you. What will happen to those sectors who were entirely dealing in the cash? What will happen? What will be the ensuing benefits of this demonetization? Will they come into the system? Will they go to the digital transaction and then eventually benefit the government?
In one line, they have no option. Simply because when GST comes in, you have to register. The GST, the way it works is it's you have to be part of the entire chain. If you're not part of the entire chain, you simply cannot work. You can probably, I theoretically see, I don't know practically how it works, but theoretically I can see some part of the business being done in cash. But
you have to come
if you think you can entirely do business in cash, I don't think anyone who's hoping that to happen post GST, I don't think that's reality.
So that serves the power of the government?
Exactly, exactly. So, which is why, and again, if I may add, if you see around Delhi, there are hoardings which are saying all traders to register for over 15 days. That was the message with the Deputy Chief Minister of Delhi. I don't know if all traders in Delhi can manage to register in 15 days. That I'm pretty certain.
Okay, okay.
Given the scale, what we're talking about, I don't think that was going to happen in 15 days. If they manage it, it's a Herculean task done and hats off to them. But I don't think that's possible.
So the present government want everyone to go digital, especially the administration.
Yeah, so, digital is an option. It's certainly, look at the efficiency it brings around for them. Managing that cash is such a huge headache. I mean, I have gone so many times after November 8th to different places. I simply refused and I said, I'm not going to pay in cash. One, I didn't have cash. Second, like many people. And second, it makes it easier.
It makes it easier. One line.
What my dear friend has said, now in India, there are certain people. Now, how do I make my sabji wala bhaiya, my dudiya, my friend who is selling tea outside a government office, my friend who is pulling a rickshaw under a metro station, how do I make them cashless? So certain people, certain section, very vital section of the society still have to operate in cash. Plus the government, if it wants to actually go cashless, now I'll tell you one thing. I travel too much on national highway number one. You have dust, you have potholes, so network and connectivity is not there.
Okay.
So if the government, my request and message to the government is, if you want us to go cashless, you have to do a lot on network and connectivity. I mean,
that's a matter of a debate, but the government has eventually want everybody to go digital.
But even US also, which certain people could say a role model country, if you go to New York City,
they are not entirely digital.
On every road, you'll have roadside carts which are selling you burgers, pizzas, hot dogs. They only deal in cash or coffee. They haven't gone cashless. So if New York City hasn't gone 100% cashless, how can we expect small towns, a Bareilly or a Bathinda or a Bikaner, to go cashless? So up to a certain extent we can get into being cashless, because in many cities of small towns of India there's no electricity. People don't understand this. Operators, 30% of our brothers and sisters are BPL, below poverty line. They are also consumers. So it would take time, I think, and a lot of effort for the government.
Cost of using cash and transaction cost of non-using cash. But that has to be kept in mind. If it is very, very small money, non-cash, mode of payment will be more costly. So I think that's not desirable either.
Okay.
We have come a long way from barter to money to the different things. isn't
but
it? Now
it
will move.
Probably the government
will
doesn't want to go entirely.
And that is why they say
last
cash. No, they have used word last cash.
Okay. Thank you very much, Ashutosh. Thank you very much, Akash Jindal. Thank you very much, Mr. Chaubey. That's all we have in this edition of Insight. Thank you very much for watching us.